To meet the fourth missile type, whose mission takes it from surface to surface, we go to sea to rendezvous with a submarine. Such a submarine, moving in toward an enemy coast in time of war, could launch its missiles from positions extremely close to target bases, relying on the guidance system within the big bird itself to finish the job. Obviously, sea launchings are not the only function of surface-to-surface missiles. Loaded into transport planes, they can be airlifted to advanced bases all over the world within easy reach of potential trouble spots everywhere. Fast airlift puts our missiles down at their remote destinations in a matter of hours. Thus, not only are they closer to possible targets, they're also well dispersed. Surprise enemy attack against so many forward bases so far apart would be difficult indeed. Some are in southern regions, as here in Africa. Others in the colder climates of the north.
The A-bomb tests at Bikini Atoll, beginning in 1946, helped in several ways to speed the development of guided missiles. First, by rapidly improving techniques for sending remotely controlled drone planes through the radioactive cloud created by the bomb blasts, the tests led to new, superior guidance systems. But even more important than the lessons in guidance was the fact of the bomb itself. Eventually, when it was sufficiently reduced in size, it could be fitted into a vehicle of reasonable dimensions, making unmanned, long-range missiles feasible. This was the warhead breakthrough. Overnight, the scientific textbooks had to be rewritten. Solution of the problems involved in long-range missiles would need the cooperation of more branches of science than any other project in history. And it would need advances in all of them. Technicians working with new metals, new fuels, even with new mathematics, created a new generation of experts with their own special tools, like electronic computers, capable of solving in 6 minutes a problem that formerly would have required 8 years of a man's life. Another is a microbarometer, so sensitive it can instantly record changes in altitude of as little as half an inch. From this vast effort has come, in 10 years, more new discoveries, new inventions, new methods than we had achieved in the preceding 10 centuries. And a new development by the aircraft industry frequently has applications in many other fields. The lightweight compact printed circuits found in guidance systems also made possible the portable radio.
Boys and girls born in the missile age list on their enrollment cards at school under occupation of father jobs that didn't exist as recently as 2 or 3 years ago. Jobs even the teacher might never have heard of before. The fathers work in factories, laboratories, and test facilities that seem to have grown between dusk and dawn. The aircraft industry's investment in America's future includes factories as clean as hospital operating rooms. For not even the tiniest speck of dust can be tolerated in the fabrication of precision products of the air age. Shoes must be spotless, clothing and hair covered with lint-free smocks and caps. Certain types of face powders and other cosmetics are forbidden. A shower of air blows away any chance dust particles that may linger, and work is passed from room to room through glass openings which permit the ultra-clean, pressurized air to blow only toward the outside of the plant. Contaminated air thus never seeps into the building. Only ultra-modern plants like this could manufacture parts for a device able to detect and correct the slightest deviation in flight by moving at speeds of thousands of miles an hour and while exposed to temperature extremes measured in thousands of degrees.
New processes are used too, for old methods have been found to be too time-consuming, inexact, and costly. Often they just couldn't handle the job. For example, here is a process called chemical milling, a process for etching metal parts to a variety of shapes and thicknesses. Another new type of machining precision parts by electrical discharge. Millions of times a second, electricity arcs between the tool and the workpiece. Each arcing removes an infinitesimal amount of metal, thus permitting accuracy measured in micro inches. Heat and vaporized metal particles are carried away by the coolant solution. automatic controls are being used more and more to hold down costs and minimize the chances of error. After the tape receives instructions just once, it can pass them on repeatedly to one or more milling machines, guiding them in the most intricate maneuvers. Only by utilizing fabulous machines and techniques like these has the aircraft industry been able to help America hold its own in the long-range missile race.
By 1957, the first type of missile to meet the requirement for ranges of 5,000 miles or more was in quantity production. Rocket engines help boost it into the air, falling back to Earth when burned out, as the missile continues on its way, now propelled by turbojet engines for the balance of the flight. Guidance is by complex, jam-resistant systems, virtually impossible for an enemy to upset by interference. Literally, it's a pilotless bomber, complete in some cases to remote-controlled, retractable landing gear. Such gear would not be installed on a missile launched on a real mission, of course, but is used on simulated practice missions to save the taxpayers many thousands of dollars by bringing the missile itself back to the ground intact. Sleek and effective, it's a comforting addition to our defense system. But even as the long-range missiles of today go into production, we are accelerating our work on greater speed, more range, higher accuracy.
Another type of long-range missile is the ballistic missile. So called because during most of its flight, it hurtles through space on a trajectory like that of an artillery shell. Its course is fixed at the moment of launching, stabilized, and corrected within the first few seconds of flight. And after that, the missile is on its own. Its rocket engines carry their own oxygen and thus can work above the atmosphere, where inertia of many thousands of miles an hour will carry the missile great distances.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1, mark X.
Ballistic missiles are being developed for a wide variety of purposes and over a wide range of action, from the battlefield bazooka up to birds with ranges of 25, 200, 500, 1500, and ultimately 5,000 miles or more. On the longer range missiles, multiple rocket engines fall off one by one as their fuel is expended. Here we see one engine falling away as the next takes over.
Development of the power plant for such journeys actually started some time ago. In laboratories and test facilities, even the rockiest crags could not hide completely. In such spots where high cliffs form natural amphitheaters and cut off some of the deafening roar, rocket engines capable of bursts rated at millions of horsepower are anchored to bedrock and fired for critical audiences of experts. Scores of projects are involved, among them tests simulating temperatures of a warhead re-entering the atmosphere, temperatures in the neighborhood of 12,000 degrees. Sometimes research results are tested in flights from ships at sea. But whether fired out here on the water, or from vast launching sites on the seacoast, or on the western desert, every time a missile goes up, new, vital information is gained. Among the subjects being probed is the question of how sudden, tremendous acceleration and absence of gravity will affect the body. Live monkeys and other animals have been sent aloft in missiles to bring back the answers. Secured in this nose cone with motion picture cameras trained on them, they will be filmed in flight. Then the nose cone will be automatically detached and parachuted gently to Earth. Careful scientific analysis of the animals and of the films will produce information of great value beyond the strictly military applications. Signal flares warn all hands to clear the area, for the spectacular ride is about to begin. Treadmill, the mice are subjected to a virtual canceling out of gravity. The nose cone is disengaged and drops back toward Earth, while scientists follow it down with radar and dispatch a helicopter to recover it and bring back the little passengers. The animals appear to be none the worse for their brief, amazing journey.
Even less concerned with military research is a project on which leading scientists, the government, and the aircraft industry have been collaborating since 1955. The ambitious project known as Vanguard, one of America's outstanding contributions to the International Geophysical Year. The objective, to establish an artificial satellite, an automatic observation post in a continuing orbit around the Earth. To do this, a three-stage rocket is employed. Shortly after firing, the first stage burns out and drops off, after boosting the second one higher and faster until it in turn burns out, leaving the third stage to achieve maximum speed and a height sufficient to establish the sphere in its orbit at roughly 18,000 miles an hour. This is the magnesium sphere itself, gold-plated for visibility, polished, and packed with miniature instruments that will detect and report back to Earth information scientists regard as momentous. As the sphere rushes around the world, it will add fresh information to our storehouse of knowledge, sending it down to us to be picked up by receiving devices specially designed for the purpose and spotted at various points on the Earth's surface. On telemetering receiving equipment, the information is recorded on tape and converted into visible records. Geography, cosmic radiation, radio and radar, the life processes of plants and animals. Just a few of the fields to be explored by the first way stations on the frontier of space.
But human space travel is for the future. For the present, the missile stands for security. Designed, developed, and produced by the same aircraft industry which gives us today's passenger and combat airplanes, the pilotless missile strengthens our defense position, increases our chances for lasting peace. It is not the ultimate weapon. There is none. But the missile is, in combination with manned aircraft and all the other weapons in our arsenal, the fastest, most direct way to deter aggression. It stands at the ready, a sobering reminder that recklessness is out of date in the conduct of world affairs.